thiên đường hay địa ngục, ở tuốc cõi trời xa. Ngày nay mới rõ ra thiên đường hay địa ngục, ngay chính cõi lòng ta mà hiện ra tất cả. Một vòng niềm dấy lên xác kịp biến tan, cho nó thôi miên địa ngục ngay hiện tiền. Ôi thật là đau điền. Thiên đường hay địa ngục thì
Get some male, get some female, yeah, mix up. So different ideas. There we go. Are we missing somebody?
Kathleen's not here.
Oh, one more person. Seven. One more question. Okay, too cool.
Maybe we'll break it down to smaller groups.
Five people.
So maybe group of four. See how it works.
Okay.
Group of four.
three back there, right?
So just kind of discuss and share with yourself your practice today based on these questions, and then, you know, any difficulties, any questions you can ask, you know, we'll bring it to Thai after this at 4:30, and he can help you. And I'll go around to help move the discussion. So go ahead. Let me read it and see if it makes sense. Okay, so I've got about six questions that I pose here. Don't necessarily have to answer all of them. You may not have time, but what resonates with you? You can, you know, answer these questions. How was today's practice compared to your regular practice? So what I mean is, you know, given the environment we created here, you know, does it help? Is it helpful? And how is it helpful to you? Think about that and see if you can take that home, and maybe you may have to adjust your practice at home to create a more helpful environment for your practice. What difficulty do you have in today's practice? So today's practice is about stillness, right? And about being unattached, regardless of what's around us. Were you able to maintain your stillness? Were you able to maintain presence with all the activities that we did? Even the yoga that we did. Were you able to see your thought before it manifests itself? So this is more of a Zen, talks about the Zen practice. The Zen practice is before the thought comes. Before you even come, can you even see it manifest itself when it's just a seed? Right? A little bit different from the Vipassana, where you let it manifest and you observe it until it dissipates. Until it dissipates. What was helpful in maintaining presence? What was helpful to you? What technique do you use to maintain your presence? Were you able to see the impermanence of thoughts and phenomena? As you go through this, the depth of practice, eventually you'll see the impermanence. Were you able to see it? And if you did, that's fine. Were you able to maintain stillness in each activity? That's kind of a repeat of what the other question was. Yeah? Any questions about those questions?
Do you want each to answer one and then pass it around?
No, no, no. I want you to discuss those things. You share your, based on these questions,
okay.
Share your practice. Yeah. Mm-hmm. You don't necessarily have to answer all those questions. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Whatever is relevant to you, your practice.
You may want to move back next to the list. Yeah. So that was a small group discussion that we did. Now there's a big group discussion, or more question for Thai. If about today's practice, about what you discuss, if you need clarification. Yeah. Or if you'd like to
comment
about your practice or about today.
Could I ask, okay, like, we're supposed to contemplate who is seeing or who is thinking. And I'm wondering if it isn't our ego that is doing the thinking, or am I on the wrong track? Apparently I'm on the wrong track. I'm sorry, shouldn't ignore me, I'll come back.
No, no, that's a good question.
Pardon?
That's a good question.
So in generally we say we are seeing, but who's seeing? Is it the ego seeing? There's two types of seeing. If you see your attachment is ego seeing. If you see without attachment, then it's the real mind seeing. You see that? So we have two type of mind. It's called two minds and four minds. So if you see in your attachment, you hear in your attachment, that's the false mind. But if you see as it is, then you're true mind, without any attachment. So to go back to your question, hey, is it my seeing? Is it the ego? What type of seeing are you seeing? If you see in your attachment, then what?
If I'm seeing the attachment.
If you're seeing with attachment.
Yeah.
Oh, then it's the ego.
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh.
Just, so, to the example that we, in the small group, you hear the word Trump, right?
Sorry. Somebody,
I'm agitated. Oh, you feel agitated? Why? What is that, when you feel agitated, why? Because the ego is seeing a concept of the word Trump, right? Because when you hear the word Trump, the first thing comes to your mind is this one person, the president right now, right?
Usually when he opens his mouth,
right. Yeah, or opens, and you have a concept, you've already had a concept about him already. Yes. That concept comes up, and you're reacting to that because of attachment. Then the ego is reacting to a concept. You're not really truly seeing the person. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
You're not truly seeing, you're seeing a concept of what you think that person is.
That's true.
So all this time we're using our ego of seeing.
I'm sorry.
So what he's saying is, for most of our life, we're seeing things or we're reacting things through our ego. We're experiencing things through our ego because of the mind wandering, the concept. Because of not being present to what is in front of us right there and there. We're attaching commentary, experiences from the past, to see, to experience what's in front of us now.
No label. No label.
No label. I promise I'll get our hearing aids.
When we're seeing our attachments without attachment, is that the true mind seeing the attachments?
When you're seeing without attachment?
When we're seeing our attachments without attachment, is that the true mind seeing the attachments?
So who's seeing that? Who's seeing the unattachment?
If the seeing has no attachment, then I think that's
no thinking, no I thinking. If I think, then there's an ego. I thinking means this ego thinking. You see that? So you have to get rid of the I. Seeing just seeing, taste just tasting. There's no I. If there's, you put an I in it, then there's an ego already. So I see this attachment, that's what? That's already an ego.
So just seeing attachment is not egoic?
It depends on how you use it.
Just being aware of it.
Just mind aware of it. And try to not hang on to the attachment. So we try to the attachment, your ego try to the attachment, or is your two mind try to the attachment? You see that? So you add the double of the attachment. I mean, your two minds are right there and you cover another term into it.
These attachments can be observed.
The attachment can be observed?
Yes, even attachments can be witnessed.
Yes, yeah, you can see it, but do you see with your true nature or you see with your ego?
If you perceive without attachment.
Sometimes we perceive attachment or non-attachment duality. you have to get out of the attachment, the attachment. If you still separate this attachment, this detachment, this duality. So the true nature is not attachment or detachment. If we are still the attachment, we're still working on it. We still use this wisdom, what we call learning wisdom, to the attachment. But the true nature of wisdom is non-attachment or non-detachment.
They say come down to label. If you're able to label it, most likely you're seeing still through the eye, because you're differentiating whether you have attachment or you see through with attachment or non-attachment. Does that make sense?
Yes. If I say I'm unattached to my attachment, there's still the I.
Yes. Yes.
Ego.
You're just following that track. Yeah.
Go ahead.
Can you talk a little bit more about the concept and an alternative way to think? Because if you've already labeled, if you've already made up your mind, can you say that person's a human being and I should show them compassion? Is that, instead of getting all worked up over whatever you think is wrong, I mean, is that a better way to approach things like that?
So in general, when we see red is red, orange orange, human, cow, we just know it, but don't label it. You see that? If you put the perception of discrimination, then you have this ego. Just like the Buddha, when he enlightened, he sees people as people, animals as animals. When you're enlightened, you cannot distinguish, there's people different from animals. You cannot say that. Because everything is the same. Cannot everything is the same. You have to know red, orange, yellow, blue. But the two natures is red, orange, yellow, and blue. But our perception, our ego say, oh, this red is beautiful, this purple, I don't like it, this is black, I don't hate it, and arise of discrimination mind. So you see how it is, everything as it is, beauty, ugly, up, down, high, low, you see everything without this monkey mind arise another thought. It's like our mind is like a mirror. Whatever comes, come. Whatever goes, go. But our mind is like a heavy glue. When somebody comes,
more like Velcro.
Yeah.
So we're working on seeing things indiscriminately.
Yeah,
indiscriminately.
See things as is suchness.
It's
not hard. Just let it be.
So one thing that may be helpful is rather than focus on the phenomena or the external object, whatever that means. When I say object, I also mean living being, not just object. Instead of being attached to that, seeing that, and dealing with that, look back on yourself. Watch your thought upon reaction to whatever that is. Watch the thought. Watch your feeling. Right, and then bring compassion to yourself. Only then do you have the compassion to be able to see the nature of what you're dealing with. Otherwise, you're seeing it discriminatory through discrimination. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Through labeling,
mm-hmm.
Right? Through identification of a concept of what you're dealing with, and through your past experience, you're taking the past experiences and you're putting that onto the